Good morning. Welcome to our Crosstie service this morning. Happy Mother's Day. Please worship with us.
Like a wildfire in my heart. Sunday morning, hallelujah, and it's lasting all week long. Can you hear it? Can you feel it? It's the rhythm of a gospel song. Once you choose it, you can't lose it. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy.
Thank you, our Crossties band. Good morning. The psalmist says in Psalm 103, to bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Let's do that this morning. All that's within us. He goes on to say, let's not forget all of his benefits. And then he lists them. He says, he forgives all of our sins. Aren't you thankful for that? He heals all of our diseases, and we're thankful that God is healing our land, our nation, and our own families. We're thankful for his healing power. He lifts us up out of the pit, and he gives us a solid place to stand, and he crowns our life with loving kindness. So we want to worship him today because he crowns us with his loving kindness, and he satisfies all of our desires so that our youth is renewed like the eagles. So we're thankful this morning that you're worshiping with us, and we're glad that the God of gods, the King of kings, the Lord of lords, is enthroned upon our praises today, and he's going to open up the windows of heaven, pour out his Holy Spirit, and minister to us on this special day, this special Mother's Day. And I look forward to the message in just a little bit as we continue to pay tribute to our moms today. Couple of announcements. You can keep sending in your tithes and offerings as you have been. You've been mighty gracious, and It's just been amazing how you've supported the church during this time when we cannot physically be here. I know you love the Lord and you love your church, so God bless you. Secondly, we'll have an announcement sometime Tuesday afternoon regarding how we will reopen and when. So just be watching for that. We're kind of in the middle trying to decide what to do. Our bishop announced last week that we're not to open till June 1st, Of course, you heard the governor mention this past Friday that churches can begin to reopen starting next week. So we're trying to decide what we're going to do. So you be praying that we'll have the wisdom that God wants us to have, because there's going to be a lot of changes when we do come back in person. A lot of things will be done differently for probably quite some time. So let's pray together. And I know it's going to be a special day when we are able to gather in person again for worship. Let's pray as we continue to worship in just a moment with our praise band. Let's give God our thanks this morning. Our Father in heaven, we bless your holy name. We hallow your name this morning. You are the God who creator. You're the God who redeems. You're the God who sustains us. We thank you, Lord, for your holy name that's above every name. We bow this morning before you because you're the Lord of Lords. Lord, we pray that your will be done this day. Lord, that your kingdom will come into our lives as we worship you. May you let your spirit flow from your throne of mercy into our hearts and lives. Change us from the inside out so that we can be everything that you want us to be, that we can be your church, your people, called according to your purpose. And Lord, that even though we cannot meet in person for worship, much ministry is happening. And we give you thanks for that. Lord, forgive us our trespasses. Lord, lead us not into temptation. Continue to be our provider. And Lord, I pray that all of those who are on the front lines of helping fight this disease, Lord, I pray for your covering, for your healing power. And we pray that soon, Lord, very soon, things will be back to more of a normal routine. Bless this land, Lord, bless our country. Pray for your peace, for your guidance. We pray for your hand of blessing. And Lord, as we do pay tribute to our moms today, Lord, I pray that we'll hear the good news from home today through your word, and that we'll be encouraged because we've been in your house, because we've been in worship. In Jesus' wonderful name we pray, amen. Let's worship him now as we continue to sing.
Sing out with me this morning.
If I told you my story, you would hear all, you wouldn't let go. If I told you my story, you would hear love, you never gave up.
Oh,
seas that are shaken and stirred can be calmed and broken for my regard. Through it all, my eyes are on you. And through it all, it is well. Through it all, my eyes are on you. And
Amen. Well, I pray that it is well with your soul this morning, and that as we listen to God's Word today, that He will help us to have that assurance that all is well with our soul. Even in the midst of a world that filled with all kind of problems, we can say it is well with my soul. I want to thank the Crossties Band again. And next Sunday during this service, our youth band will be leading worship for us. We look forward to that. And the Crossties Band deserves a well-deserved rest. They've been doing this for several weeks, and I know you appreciate that. And we want to thank them, and I know you will when you see them. Today we are going to try to do two things. We're going to study God's Word, and we're going to look in John chapter 14, verse 15 through 21. And we're also going to pay tribute to our moms. Everybody has a mom or had a mom, and we want to lift up our moms. I'm going sometime this afternoon down to Gardendale. My mother's in assisted living there. And even though I can't go into her room, I'm going to stand outside her window and at least talk to her on the phone where she can see me. Because I'm a Christian today. I'm a believer in the Lord Jesus because of a godly mom and dad who love the Lord. And I never doubted, not for one moment, that God is real, because I saw the Lord in their lives. And I never doubted the Creator. I never doubted that He's real. And I pray today that He will give us that assurance. And by the way, next Sunday I'm going to be sharing a message on assurance as we continue the theme of post-resurrection, pre-Pentecost. Jesus says in the passage that we're going to be reading today that when that day comes, and He's looking forward to Pentecost as He ascends and the Spirit comes, He says, you're going to know. You're going to know that I'm in the Father, that you're in me, and I'm in you. Let's let God give us that blessed assurance that Jesus is ours. So I look forward to next week's message already. So today, let's read together from John 14. Verse 15 through 21, I'm reading from the New Living Translation. If you love me, Jesus says, obey my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and He will give you another advocate or helper who will never leave you. He is the Holy Spirit who leads into all truth. The world cannot receive Him because it isn't looking for Him and doesn't recognize Him. But you know Him because He lives with you now and later will be in you. Verse 18, no, I will not abandon you as orphans. I will come to you. Soon the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Since I live, you also will live. Jesus says, since I'm alive and going to be alive forever, you also will be alive. You will live. Verse 20, when I'm raised to life again, you will know that I'm in the Father and that you're in me and I'm in you. Those who accept my commandments and obey them are the ones who love me. And because they love me, my Father will love them and I will love them and reveal myself to each of them. Lord, thank you for your word. Reveal through your word today to us your plan. We're thankful for, Lord, your plan from before the foundation of this world for each of us to be in you and to have life. I pray that you'll permit me to preach. Lord, hide me behind the cross. As we lift up the cross today, as we lift up Jesus, I thank you for the good things that are going to happen through the power of your Spirit, ministering through your word. We thank you for the wisdom of your word. And Lord, let us understand it today, this passage that we're going to be looking at. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. Some kids were trying to figure out where babies come from. And one said, well, they come from the stork. And another one said, no, they don't. They come from UPS. UPS drops them off. And another one just ended it all. He said, babies are attached to their moms by a biblical cord. And I want this message today that we'll all be attached, not just to our moms through a biblical cord, but that's part of this message. We need more godly moms and fathers and grandparents so that all of our families, all of our kids are attached to the Word of God. And we pray the Lord will open up the windows of heaven today and pour out His blessings through His Word. But I want to take just a couple of moments to pay tribute to our moms today. Billy Sunday, the famous evangelist, one time said to husbands, he said, "Try praising your wife even if it does frighten her at first." Men, tell your wives today you love them. Second, this is a church sign that was spotted. It says, "If evolution is true, how come mothers still have only two hands?" And then there's a story about the little boy who was 4, about to turn 5, and he had learned when somebody said, "How old are you?" he would hold up 4 fingers. So the night before he was going to turn 5, his mother said, now, son, you realize this is the last day you're going to be 4. In the morning when you wake up, you're going to be 5. And he was thinking about that, and he was ready. And she said, "Now, do you understand that in the morning you're going to be 5? And he held up his 4 fingers plus his thumb. He said, "Mom, tomorrow morning I'm going to be a handful." And for all of our moms who have had a handful raising their kids, I want to pay tribute today to you through God's Word, that we will be ministered to, that we'll be encouraged, and that we'll be strengthened to keep on running the race, keep on being everything that God wants us to be. Linda Huckins in the Christian Reader. Linda's from Massachusetts. She was telling the story about her daughter's wedding. She wanted everything to be perfect. Even though we're not perfect, even though we're not perfect moms or dads, she wanted to be perfect for this 1 hour. And she was going up to light her part of the unity candle. And she said she didn't realize it, but she got too close to the flame and her acrylic nail caught on fire. And she said she didn't want to spoil the fun for her daughter, that ceremony. So she went ahead and lit her candle with her nail that was on fire. And then she said, like a gunslinger, "I blew it out like I was blowing out my 6-shooter. She said, "I was the talk of the reception after the service." Moms do all kind of things for their kids. And today I want to try and draw a parallel as we look at this lesson out of John 14 about how the Holy Spirit ministers. I'm pretty sure because God wants us to be able to help one another, that we'll see how moms are like this passage. God is our Heavenly Father, but we see in John 14 here how He loves us like a mother loves. Verse 18 is our text verse for this morning, and Jesus said, "I am not going to leave you alone. I'm not going to leave you as an orphan. I will come to you." Doesn't that sound like a mother's love? There was a survey done one time about who shows the most comfort at home. Dads or moms? 23% of those who responded said dads. 77% said moms show the most comfort. Today, I want to mention 3 quick things, 3 words to help us to draw a parallel between how God comforts us and how God wants moms and dads and all of us to be a comfort to help one another. First of all is the word presence. The Holy Spirit is with us. Jesus said that I'm not going to leave you alone. I'm going to come to you. We see from this passage that we're not alone because God's with us. His Spirit's with us. One of the greatest gifts that you can ever give to anyone is the gift of your presence, just being there. Susan and I, we have been supporting a little boy from Mexico, Emmanuel, for several years now. We send our money through Compassion International, and we get oftentimes every month a reminder, a letter, maybe from Emmanuel. But I have to confess, it's harder for me to think about Emmanuel, to pray for Emmanuel, to love Emmanuel, and I'm just being honest with you right now, because I don't see Emmanuel. He's in Mexico, and we send our money. Susan writes the check each month. And walking by, occasionally I'll look on the refrigerator, and there's his picture, and I'll be reminded. But it's not like our kids and our grandkids that I see all the time. See, physical presence makes a huge difference. And that's one of the reasons Jesus said, I've got to go away. He's telling his disciples here in John 14, 15, 16, it's better for you that I go away. He mentions that in chapter 16, verse 7. It's better for you that I go away because If I go away, then the Comforter is going to come. The Holy Spirit, the Paraclete, is going to come, and he's going to be with you. So we have God's presence with us. Oh, how important presence is. Jesus, if he were still in his physical body over in the Holy Land, that wouldn't be very comforting to you and me here, right here in Hartselle, Alabama, wherever you're watching. But because he said, I'm going away, and the Spirit's going to come to be with you and within you. So we know this morning we have the presence of God's Spirit. And moms, we congratulate you. We thank you today because of your presence, for being there, for loving us, for taking care of us. There's an old saying, I don't remember where it came from, but the hand that rocks the cradle rules the world, and we believe that. The closest thing to God's love in this world that we can ever experience is a mother's love. They're making their commitment to be present, to love us. And that leads to a second thing that I see in this passage. And let's talk for just a moment about the word perception. The word perception or perceiving. Jesus says in this passage, he says that I'm going to be with you. I'm going to understand you. I'm going to care for you. I'm going to love you. The Spirit, we're not going to leave you alone. Listen to verse 15, 16 again. He says, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. And I'll ask the Father, and he'll give you another helper who will never leave you. He is the Holy Spirit who leads you into all truth. Physical presence is wonderful, but it's not enough. Just physical presence is not near enough to make sure our kids and our grandkids and those that are within our area of responsibility are going to make it in this. We're going to be successful in God's sight. And that's where Jesus shines. Jesus, he understood. Jesus cared. Jesus loved. And if we're going to be successful as parents, if we're going to be successful as Christians, just making a difference in this world, there has to be the physical presence, but there also has to be the perception, the understanding, the caring. Jesus, I believe that's one of the reasons the kids just flocked to Jesus, because they knew he cared. He loved them. He said, let the children come to me. This is what the kingdom of heaven is all about. Jesus cared about those who are physically unclean. Jesus went to the lepers. One day a leper said, Lord, if you're willing, you can make me clean. Most of the people would stay far enough away from the lepers that the breeze that blew from the lepers couldn't come close enough to them. There was a certain amount of footage that they had to stay away from lepers, and lepers would have to cry, unclean, unclean, don't come close. But Jesus went close that day, and he said, I am willing, and he touched the leper. He touched him, and the leper was cleansed. Jesus cared about those who were sick in their sins, who were sick unto death because of their sins. The woman at the well, Jesus ministered to in John chapter 4, and he helped her to see that he was the Messiah, and he was the one who could give her living water and should never be spiritually thirsty again. Jesus not only was present, but he cared, he understood, he ministered to, he helped. The thief on the cross, the penitent thief, the one who said, he's done nothing wrong. Remember me, Lord, when you come into your kingdom. Jesus said, today you're going to be with me in paradise. So presence is important, but also just having the ability to understand, perceiving, and caring enough. Irma Bombeck, many of you have read a lot of her writings. Irma Bombeck, course, is a mother. She wrote this about her favorite child. Do you have a favorite child if you're a parent this morning? Well, Irma says you do. Listen to what she wrote. Every mother has a favorite child. She can't help it. She's only human. I have mine, the child for whom I feel a special closeness, with whom I share a love that no one else could possibly understand. My favorite child is the one who has to be sick to eat ice cream at his birthday party, who had the measles at Christmas, who wore leg braces to bed because he towed in, who had a fever in the middle of the night, the asthma attack, the child in my arms at the emergency room. My favorite child spent Christmas alone away from the family, was stranded after the game with a gas tank on empty, lost the money for his class ring. My favorite child is the one who messed up the piano recital, misspelled committee in a spelling bee, ran the wrong way with the football, had his bike stolen because he was careless. My favorite child is the one I punished for lying, grounded for insensitivity to other people's feelings, and informed he was a royal pain to the entire family. And my favorite child slammed doors in frustration, cried when she didn't think I saw her, withdrew, and said she could not talk to me. My favorite child always needed a haircut, had hair that wouldn't curl, had no date for Saturday night, and a car that cost $600 to fix. My favorite child was selfish, immature, bad-tempered, and self-centered. He was vulnerable, lonely, unsure of what he was doing in this world, and quite wonderful. All mothers have their favorite child. It is always the same one, the one who needs you at that moment, who needs you for whatever reason, to cling to shout at, to hurt, to hug, to flatter, to unload on, but mostly just to be there. And I say amen to that. Our favorite child, the one who needs us. Jesus understands. We can never say to our Heavenly Father, you don't understand, because he's been there with us, and he's with us now. So there's the word presence. He's with us just as moms are with their kids. He perceives, he understands. And then the third word I want to mention is the word power. He gives us the power of his presence to overcome our problems. Because he's with us, he gives us the power to overcome. In verse 18, we saw where Jesus said, I'm not going to leave you as orphans. Then in verse 19, he says, since I live, you also will live. I'm very thankful this morning that we're not all alone in this, that we're not trying to be godly people, godly mothers, godly parents, godly grandparents, godly uncles and aunts without the strength from God's presence. He gives us the ability to overcome, to endure, because he is alive and his spirit lives in us. And we need to teach that truth to the generations that follow us. We need to make sure we're teaching truth to our kids. If there's just one mother, just one dad today who takes this message to heart, it's worth it. That someone will decide, I'm going to teach truth into my kids. Romans 12:2 says, don't let the world mold you into its image. Don't be conformed to be like the world. We need to hear that as adults. Our kids need to be taught that. Don't let the world squeeze you into its mold, because this world we live in will do that. We need our kids, we need all of us to be different by the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, there's two ways you can teach truth. You can do it negatively, or you can do it positively. Negatively is just basically stating the things that you're against. I read where TCU, Texas Christian University, was founded in 1873. And one of the things that they used as they were announcing their beginning, they said, we are 40 miles away from any known sin. Well, that's not the way it works, is it? God has not called us to get out of the world. He's called us to be in the world, but not to let the world conform us into its image. So we need to teach the truth to our kids positively. We need to uplift Jesus. We need to uplift our values, what we do believe in as Christians. It's kind of like a pilot in a small plane taking off the runway in a small airport at night. The attendant will turn on the lights on that little airstrip. Those lights don't dispel the darkness, but they just help the pilot to have a good start, to have a good takeoff. And that's what God's calling us, you and me, to be. We will not dispel the darkness around us, but we can be light to give our kids a good start, that they can make it in this world. How do you teach truth? Well, there's four basic ways. One way to teach truth is directly. We need to teach the truth directly. That's through rules. That's through commandments. That's through laws. It's the shallowest level, but it's very important. We learn rules all through our life. This morning as I was leaving our house and I pulled out on Divine's Drive from our house, you know what I did? I looked both ways before I pulled out into the road. Because I was taught that as a child. Anytime you go out into the road, make sure you look both ways. Rules like that are important. We can't make it without rules, without guidelines. The Bible teaches us we're to honor the Sabbath and keep it holy. Sunday's a special day. We're told in the Bible to honor our parents. And that's one of the things we're trying to do today. Those are rules. Those are regulations that God gives us. We live in a world all around us where we're taught rules. We all learn the ABCs. There's 26 letters. They don't change. They all make certain sounds. You can't just pretend that they're different. They're the same. We're taught that our capital is in Washington, D.C. Someone with authority tells us the truth, and we just listen to it, accept it, and live it. That's one way to learn truth. There's another way to learn truth. It goes a little deeper. That's indirectly. Indirectly through stories, or through parables. Jesus taught indirectly the truth a lot of times. We hear the story about the Good Samaritan. And how he was the only one. The religious leaders, they went on the other side of the road. But not the Good Samaritan. That's why he's called the Good Samaritan even today. He did what was right. And we hear a story like that, a parable like that, and we realize how many times we've gone on the opposite side of the road not to help. Truth kind of sneaks up on us, slips up on us. The publican and the sinner in church praying, Jesus told the story about the publican thought he was righteous, and he said, God, I'm thankful I'm not like that man over there. And that man over there was on his face before God, beating his chest and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Jesus said, that's the one. That's the one whose prayers were answered. The truth sneaks up on us. And we say, I've been too prideful. I've been too much like that publican. I've not been humble enough like that poor sinner. Truth is learned directly, indirectly. It's learned incarnately. We learn it through others. When I was in high school, I learned Spanish. I had Spanish for 2 years. I didn't learn a whole lot, but Miss Brasher did teach us a little bit that I remember. I didn't know the language, and we learned truth incarnately through others. We didn't know God's language, and He sent His only Son, Jesus Christ, into this world to speak a language we can understand. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we could learn truth incarnately when we look to truth, when we look to Jesus, our Savior. And there's another way we can learn truth, and that's experientially. When we experience the truth. A few years ago, after Daniel and Rebecca were out of the house, they're now married with kids. Susan and I had eaten breakfast at Cracker Barrel lots of times, and they used to have pure maple syrup. You get their pancakes, and then you get that little bottle, and it said pure maple syrup. If you go to Cracker Barrel today, it'll just say pure natural syrup. It's not pure maple syrup any longer. But Susan started buying pure maple syrup. And when she fixes her pancakes once a week, and we get that pure maple syrup, and we pour on those pancakes, it's just out of the... You cannot beat pure maple syrup. You can hear about it. You can look at it on the shelves in the store. But until you experience it, you don't know what you're missing. And that's the truth of God's plan for our lives. You see, God has a plan for you. You have a part in it, and Jesus Christ is the link. When we experience Jesus, our Savior, we get properly linked up, properly lined up with God, and no longer is truth just something we've heard. No longer is truth just something that we believe. No longer is truth just something to kind of see in somebody else and say, if I ever become a Christian, I want to be like so-and-so. Now we can experience truth. Jesus says, I'm going to send the Spirit of truth to be with you, and He's going to be in you, and you're going to understand. There's nothing more wonderful. There's nothing more marvelous in this world than the presence of God. And that's one of the things that he's promising. Jesus is promising us here in John 14 that God's presence will cover us. You're not going to be orphans. And that's one of the wonderful things about a godly mother, a godly parent. Not only will there be their presence, that's important. Not only will there be the understanding, that's even better. But a godly parent will provide the ability for their kids to have the tools they need to be successful. Ben Carson, all of you have heard of Dr. Ben Carson. He's now the secretary for HUD, retired neurosurgeon, wrote several books. Ben Carson told the story that when he and his brother were small, his mother made them read a book every couple of weeks. And they had to write a book report about that book they had read. And he did it for years. Every couple of 3 weeks, he'd read the book, he'd write the book report. He was very careful in writing the book report because he had given it to his mother. He said he didn't find out until he was in junior high school that his mother was illiterate, that she couldn't read a word of what he was writing. But she held up the standard, and they became successful because she expected it of them. She not only provided her presence, she not only understood her kids, she provided them with the resources, the tools to make it. So moms, we want to congratulate you today. We want to thank you for what you've done. And I believe all of us are hungry for more of the Holy Spirit in our lives. We need His presence. We need His covering, His understanding, His presence. We need His power. When the presence of God covers us, it's like Ezra said in the Old Testament, when His gracious hand is resting upon us, good things are going to happen. Don't try and make it in this world. Kids, listen to your parents. Listen to your Sunday school teachers. Read God's Word, because you're not going to be successful in this world if you get out from under God's covering, God's presence. When God's presence envelops us, people who want to say no to us are going to wind up saying yes, because there's just an aura, there's just a personality, the power of the Holy Spirit emanating from a person who's living in the presence of Almighty God. I want to close the message this morning. There's a poem that I have heard most of my life. I've read it at many funerals. It talks about, the title of the poem is, "Are All the Children In?" And the author's unknown, at least to me. And he writes, I think oftentimes as the night draws nigh of an old house on the hill, of a yard that's all wide and blossom starred, where the children played at will. And when the night at last came down, hushing the merry din, mother would look around and ask, "Are all the children in?" 'Tis many and many a year since then, and the old house on the hill no longer echoes to childish feet. The yard is still, so still. But I see it all as the shadows creep, and though many the years have been since then, I can hear my mother ask, "Are all the children in?" I wonder if when the shadows fall on the last short earthly day, when we say goodbye to the world outside, all tired with our childish play, when we step into that other land where mother so long has been, will we hear her ask just as of old, "Are all the children in?" Are all the children in? Are you in this morning? We're either in or out. We've either accepted Christ as our Savior, repented of our sins, or we haven't. I know you've had somebody in your life who's loved you, who's prayed for you, and is wondering today, are you in? Have you come to faith? As we pray in just a moment, I want to ask you to do that so that you can always be the person God wants you to be. The wife, the mother, the husband, the person, the worker, the teacher, the person God wants you to be. A few years ago, I preached a revival in Wilsonville, Alabama, south of Birmingham, at Old Chapel United Methodist Church. One night, a young lady came forward and prayed to receive Jesus as her Savior. Her 9 or 10-year-old son quickly followed her mother to the altar. Michael is his name. Michael also prayed that night with me. On the last night of the revival, little Michael looked up at me as I was getting ready to leave, and he said, "Preacher, I'm going to always be a church man." I want to ask you this morning, will you always be a church man or woman? Will you always live for Jesus? You see, he was following in the footsteps of his mother. Moms, dads, parents, grandparents, let's lead those who are watching. As the contemporary song says today, I don't care about leaving a legacy about me. I want to leave a legacy about Jesus so that lives will continue to be transformed. Pray with me. Lord, we thank you for the power of your presence, that you care about us, that you understand all about our needs. No matter our lot in life this morning, no matter where we are, what we've done, who we're with, Lord, you love us. And you have a plan to redeem our lives. As we said out of Psalms earlier, Lord, you forgive all of our sins. You lift us up out of the pit, and you change our desires, and you crown our lives with loving kindness. So we bless you this morning. And Lord, I pray for your strength to be our strength today, for your help to be with us. I pray that we'll make a quality decision right now to let you be the Lord of our lives, the Savior of our life. Lord, redeem us. We ask you to forgive us. Come in and lead and guide and direct us, Lord, so that others who follow in our footsteps will always know truth, and they'll know the truth, that his name is Jesus, and he's our Savior, and we bless his name this morning. Amen. God bless you.
Thank you.
Thank you for worshiping with us today. Let's remember that He promised to be with us. So we have the power of the Spirit within us to do what He asks us to do. Go forth and be the child of the King and walk in the light and be the salt of the earth. We will have an announcement sometime Tuesday afternoon about when and how we will be opening back up, in case you missed that a little bit earlier. So watch for our announcement, and let's pray together that God will continue to pour out His Spirit as we call on His name, as we turn from our sins, as we seek His face. He said, I will hear, I'll forgive, and I'll heal your land. Lord, we love you. We thank you for first loving us, for giving us the ability to respond to love you. Thank you for letting us be in relationship with you. Lead and guide and bless us this day and this week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you.